My name is Asta Heinesen, and together with Hayley Macpherson, I'm going to talk about Hubble's law in general spacetimes. In particular, we are going to talk about a numerical relativity study, which we conveyed of anisotropic signatures that we could expect to see in the luminosity distance signal. Typically in cosmology, we analyze data in an isotropic manner, and isotropic model assumptions and isotropic data analysis strategies go back to the very foundation of general relativistic cosmology and the data analysis being done at the time. For instance, the first estimate of the Hubble parameter made by Hubble himself was based on an isotropic analysis where Hubble plotted distances against redshift of the sources of his survey, independent on the direction on the sky of these sources. And he did a fit of a straight line to these data points, the slope of which we today identify as the Hubble parameter that goes into the Hubble-Lemaitre law that prescribes distances to close by sources in an expanding universe model. The reason that Hubble conveyed an isotropic analysis at the time was perhaps not that he necessarily thought of the universe around us being particularly homogeneous or isotropic. It was perhaps more from a practical point of view that data was so sparse at the time, so it would be unrealistic to try to resolve any physical anisotropy around us in our universe. But today we have large cosmological data sets available. Modern supernova catalogs consist of the order of thousands of supernova, and within this decade we are going to have access to hundreds of thousands of supernova of type 1a. And it is then interesting to see if we can use this precision that we are going to have in data in order to convey a more detailed analysis of standardizable objects in cosmology. In order to do this, we need some theory to understand the anisotropies that we would expect to see in the distance redshift relation. I will just briefly remind you of some results from the Friedman, Lemaitre, Robertson-Walker class of geometries. Here we have that the luminosity distance can be expanded into a power series in redshift, where the first order term is the usual Hubble law. When we go to a higher order, we have the deceleration parameter entering, which is the second time derivative of the scale factor, which comes with a minus sign by convention. When we go to yet higher order, we have curvature entering through the FLRW curvature parameter. We also have the so-called jerk parameter entering, which is the third time derivative of the scale factor. And I should note that these are purely geometrical results. They rely only on the FLRW metric ansatz, and this is sometimes referred to FLRW cosmography. And now we are going to try to generalize this cosmography to an arbitrary space-time setting, not assuming homogeneity or isotropy in particular. So the aim is now to prescribe the luminosity distance cosmography for an arbitrary space-time setting. And so we are going to map the coefficients. We're going to map the FLRW, Hubble, deceleration jerk, and curvature parameters into inhomogeneous parameters that now describes the luminosity distance signal for physical observers in an inhomogeneous and anisotropic space-time. And I can just mention the key results of this paper. here we get that the Hubble parameter that generalizes the Hubble parameter of FLRW cosmology is given by the rate of change of energy along the photon four momentum. And we have that the effective deceleration parameter, which takes the place of the FLRW deceleration parameter in the luminosity distance cosmography, is given by the gradient of this curly H function, this generalized Hubble parameter along the photon null lines. When we go to higher order, we have the generalized curvature parameter entering, which contains this focusing term, that's the projection of the Ricci tensor along the photon four momentum. And we have the jerk parameter, which is given by the second derivative of the curly H function. And now we can exploit the fact that these generalized cosmological parameters can be written on the form of simple multiple expansions in the direction of incoming light E. This is the position of the source on the as seen by the observer on the sky. We can write these parameters in terms of truncated multiple series in this direction of incoming light. And the Hubble, the generalized Hubble parameter is in this formalism given by a series expansion that's truncated at quadrupolar order. We have the monopole, which describes the isotropized expansion rate of the observer congruents. We have the dipolar term, which describes the four acceleration of the observer congruents when this is not geodesic. And we have the quadrupolar term, which describes the shearing of the observer congruents. And when we go to higher order, we in a similar fashion have that the generalized deceleration parameter is given by a truncated multiple series, now truncated at fourth order. And similarly, we have that the jerk minus curvature parameter, which determines the third order term in the luminosity distance cosmography, is given by a series expansion that's truncated at sixth order. And the nice thing about these expressions is that they are given in terms of a finite number of degrees of freedom incorporated in these multiple coefficients. And these multiple coefficients are furthermore of cosmological interest. They describe the kinematics of the observer congruents. So they describe the expansion, the shearing of space, and so on, and incorporate curvature invariance as well, physical quantities that we would be interested in from a cosmological viewpoint. And so I can just note that this formalism allows, in principle, to do a fully model-independent analysis of standardizable objects in cosmology, because the luminosity distance cosmography is given in terms of a finite number of parameters in each order, at each order in redshift. This formalism, it allows us to do a full analysis of the raw data without any a priori assumptions or corrections to our data sets. It allows us to do a motivated search of anisotropies, because we can infer the signatures that we would expect to see in various model settings. An interesting topic is also to investigate the signatures we would expect in realistic numerical simulations with realistic observers. And this is what Hayley is now going to talk about.
Thanks, Asta. So my name's Hayley, and now I'm going to tell you about our application of Asta's new generalized formalism to the case of realistic numerical simulations. And specifically, I'm going to talk about this paper here, in which we use numerical relativity simulations of cosmological structure formation to assess the levels of anisotropy measured by synthetic observers in these simulations using Asta's generalized formalism. And the reason we used numerical relativity for this was that because this formalism contains no assumptions on the form of the metric tensor, we really wanted our simulations to as closely reflect this generality as possible. And that is why we use numerical relativity, which is a really useful computational method that allows us to solve Einstein's field equations with no simplifying assumptions for gravity or geometries. And this is based on 3+1 split of space-time into a three-dimensional space component and a one-dimensional time component. And this kind of split just allows us to project Einstein's four-dimensional equations into these three-dimensional hypersurfaces. And then Einstein's equations become a set of evolution equations for the quantities describing these spatial surfaces. And this is a really successful method that's been used for many decades now to simulations of relativistic objects like binary black holes and binary neutron stars. And more recently, it's been applied to kind of inhomogeneous and anisotropic cosmology. In the interest of time, I'll just give some more details about how we do it specifically. So we use a code called the Einstein Toolkit, which is a free open source numerical relativity code. We've written a module called FLRW Solver to generate realistic cosmological initial conditions to then be evolved using full numerical relativity and all the really widely used routines in the Einstein Toolkit. So before I go on, just a note about smoothing. In Asta's series expansion, she did have to assume her effective Hubble parameter needs to be differentiable and positive everywhere that we want to apply the series. So this means that we can't have any kind of collapse happening in the simulation. And that then means we need to define some kind of smoothing scale to cut out small scale nonlinear structure. The way that we do this is just to choose our grid cells to be really large so that we can really be sure that there are no small scale dynamics going on in the simulation and we meet the requirements to be able to apply this series expansion everywhere in the simulation. Specifically, we choose conservative smoothing scales. So we have two simulations, one with grid cells of 100 megaparsec and another with grid cells of 200 megaparsec. Here is a snapshot of redshift zero of the simulation, one of the simulations that we used in this work. So these are two-dimensional slices through a three-dimensional domain. And on the top left, we have the density field. On the top right, the expansion rate. Down here is the shear field, and here's the acceleration. So these three panels are the contributing factors into the effective Hubble parameter in Asta's generalized series expansion. And I will also emphasize again that we have no dark energy in the evolution of these simulations. So that generally means we're going to have larger density contrasts than in a lambda CDM simulation. We do find that when we average on large scales in these simulations, in terms of the cosmological parameters, these agree with the Einstein de Sitter model to within our numerical errors. So once we actually have these simulations, our process of calculating the effective parameters here is to place the observers randomly within the simulation domain. And then each observer gets assigned a certain set of lines of sight. This amounts to a unique emu for each observer and for each independent line of sight as well. And so for each of these, we calculate the effective Hubble parameter here. And then the other parameters are built from derivatives of the effective Hubble parameter along the incoming null ray. And then the effective curvature parameter also requires this Ricci focusing term, which is the contraction of the photon of form momentum with the Ricci curvature of space-time at the observer position. And so let's first consider a set of observers with some really, really well sampled skies. So we randomly place 100 observers and each of them get just over 12,000 isotropic lines of sight. So here's a projection of what these lines of sight look like on each observer's sky. And so then for each one of these lines of sight, for each of our observers, we calculate all of the effective cosmological parameters. And then we're really able to get some high resolution maps of the any anisotropy these observers might measure. And so here in each panel, what I'm showing is, this is just for one random observer. Each one shows the an effective cosmological parameter normalized by their relevant Einstein de Sitter value. So here's the effective Hubble parameter. normalized by the Einstein de Sitter H naught, so about 45 kilometers per second per megaparsec. On the top right is the deceleration parameter normalized by the Q naught in EDS, so about 0.5. The curvature parameter here is not normalized because it's zero in Einstein de Sitter. And here is the jerk parameter relative to one, which is the jerk parameter in Einstein de Sitter. And so I'll just point out here that we obviously have some quite significant anisotropy in these parameters. And specifically, we have a quadrupolar anisotropy dominating the effective Hubble parameter and a dipolar anisotropy dominating the deceleration parameter. We notice that this observer in some directions has a 6% larger Hubble parameter than the global mean, which corresponds to the universe in which they live. And in some other directions, they see an effective Hubble parameter of 4% lower than the global properties of their universe. Because remember, these Einstein de Sitter values really do reflect the global properties of the simulation in which these observers live. And so we can imagine if this observer didn't quite sample their sky fairly, if they had preferentially more supernova over here than over here, then the Hubble parameter they infer from those supernovae might not truly reflect the global properties of their universe. And this is just for one specific observer. At a glance, you can see that all the observers see really different anisotropy, though we do typically see this quadrupolar dominant in the Hubble parameter and typically a dipole present in the deceleration parameter and the curvature parameter. But this is not really reflective of what our observations are like here on Earth. And so instead, let's consider a sky sampling that looks something like this. So here, what we've done is we've considered 1,000 observers who have this fairly sampled sky, 300 random lines of sight chosen in random directions across the observer's sky. And we calculate the cosmological parameters for each direction and then take an average over the whole sky. And so here, each panel shows a different effective cosmological parameter, not again normalized to their Einstein de Sitter values, as a function of the density contrast at the observer's position. And so each one of these points is for an individual observer who has calculated the effective parameters along each line of sight and taken an average of the result. And so we expect this to be, since this is a fairly well-sampled sky, we expect this to be a good approximation for the monopole contribution to these effective parameters. And so you can think of this as a kind of a measure of the cosmic variance. So really how these parameters vary as you take different physical locations inside the simulation. And so I'll note that we see quite significant variance in these parameters as a function of the local density. And I'll just note that the variance we find in the Hubble parameter is in rough agreement with other studies that have looked at the cosmic variance in the Hubble parameter in n-body simulations and in analytic models, when they consider the same smoothing scales or the same level of density contrast that we have. But we also have, on top of this cosmic variance, an additional anisotropic contribution across the observer's sky as well, which might affect the case of an unfair sky sampling in a survey, for example. And so we quantify this with this maximal sky deviation delta, which is just maximum minus the minimum normalized by the Einstein de Sitter value. And so we calculate this for all 1,000 of our observers with their fairly sampled skies with 300 lines of sight. And this is what we get. So each panel here is a different parameter and each cross represents an individual observer's their maximal sky variance in each parameter. And the main thing I want to point out here is that this anisotropy does not depend on the local density at the observer. So we notice that even observers who are sitting in with essentially zero over density, so really in regions that reflect the mean density of the universe, they can still measure anywhere between 4% to 12, even 13, maybe 14% variance across their sky in the Hubble parameter, and much, much larger for the deceleration parameter and curvature and jerk. So just to quickly summarize, the main thing really, the coefficients of the luminosity distance redshift relation generalize in non-trivial ways in the presence of local inhomogeneity and anisotropy. And in our study, we find differences from the FLRW equivalence, even in the monopole limits. And on top of this cosmic variance, we found that the parameters varied quite significantly across individual observer skies. And this could have a significant impact if surveys have incomplete sky coverage. Studies like this can help us in determining what might constitute a reasonable assumption in simplifying Asta's formalism to really be able to apply it to data sooner rather than later. So thank you so much for having us. Here are both of our email addresses if you want to get in touch. and contact us with any questions, and we look forward to the discussions to have about this work. Thank you.